and I like it very much. But that's, anyway, you get your point. So, 14, three more points for that. That makes it 17.
Oh, isn't that right? Oh, I've just done that, haven't I? Yeah.
So, you've only got 14. So hang on to that. Is that right?
Yeah.
Sorry, remember the girls. I got carried away with that, as you say. I'll give you another three, and that balances it up.
Yeah, that's
good. Thank you. Marvellous.
You forgot the VAT to go.
Can I sit there? There's a lovely... Right, Bernie, there you are.
A clip there from Thames TV's Give Us a Clue with Michael Aspel. Michael's in the studio with us today. I understand that when you left school, you started working for publishers as a T-boy. Mm. At that stage, did you want to go into working to radio or television, or were those thoughts far from your mind?
No, at that time, I wanted to be a cartoonist or a writer, which is how I got to be a T-boy in a publishing house, which is the nearest I got to being a writer. But I wanted to be an actor and a cartoonist or a writer, three of those things. I never got to be a cartoonist, but I have done... Although I did do some cartoons in the army, actually, later on. And I've done a bit of writing since, and I've done some acting, so partly fulfilled, but I'm sort of a dilettante now without having specialised in any one.
Mm. Did you have any idea that you're going to become as well-known at that sort of very early stage?
No, it was always the hope, but a television announcer, newsreader, compere was a thing that didn't exist when I was a child, so I never thought that I would end up doing this. I got waylaid sort of halfway along, and I wanted really to do just one or the other of those things, and not the kind of animal that I have become. And I'm still not, haven't decided quite what I want to do for a living.
So you first went into broadcasting after leaving the army?
Yes, I did. I didn't want to go back into the publishing game because I really didn't think that was what I wanted to do. And the great thing about national service, which generally was a bore, I thought, and a waste of time, and I would refuse the invitation to return, is the great thing was that it gave you time to reappraise what you might do. And I might have stuck at being a T-boy, becoming a representative and staying in the book trade. But it gave me a chance to think again. And when I didn't want to go back to that company, they were very kind and said, get out. So I scouted around and took a job with a bedding firm, and they sent me to Cardiff to learn the retail trade, and I went because I had nothing else to do. While I was there, I met some broadcasters, and because I had this parrot thing of doing accents and voices, someone said, why don't you have a try for an audition? And I did, and I was on the air the next week, and decided, and Children's Hour serial play, and decided, well, I didn't want to stay in the bed trade, and it developed from there.
So what sort of voices did you do?
Well, the first part I played was Captain O'Haggerty, who was the villain in this Children's Hour thing. It was a very rotten Irish accent, but as this was in Cardiff, I got away with it. And it developed from there. And I had to do other jobs in the meantime to see me through, because they only gave me occasional broadcasts. So I did the proverbial digging up drain pipes and cutting grass and that sort of thing. In fact, I'd be playing an aristocrat in the afternoon, having just scrape the cement off the boots and that kind of thing. So it was an interesting and varied life, but I didn't know where it was going to lead.
So you didn't sort of have any firm plans, you just sort of went because it was the only thing for you to do?
I thought I would be an actor then, and I did get taken on the Cardiff Drama Repertory Company at £10 a week. And I didn't really think that I needed to look any further. I was earning 10 quid a week, which was wonderful money, and I was an actor. And I just thought I'd rest on my laurels for the rest of my life.
So how did you get into television?
Well, at that time, this was in about 1954, I was doing the radio drama. And in fact, I actually took part in some Welsh language programs. And I, of course, don't speak Welsh, but they taught me parrot fashion. And I was going, Agawe clip with Gorabisk, and not knowing what I was talking about. Yes. But at the same time, they had up at Lime Grove, back at headquarters, guest television announcers wearing the communal dinner suit. There was just one jacket, no trousers, actually, because they cut there. So you wore shorts or grey flannels. And I was asked if I wanted to go back up to London, because I am a Londoner. To test as an announcer. I can't even say, never been able to say an announcer, but that's what they tested me for.
Yes.
And I got through that without too many stumbles and was taken on a sort of fortnightly basis wearing this huge dinner suit.
So you started off your life in broadcasting as a straight man, so how did you get into the whole area of Crackerjack and that sort of thing?
Yes, it's a good question. It doesn't seem to have any connection, does it? Well, I was sitting there, as I said, in the bow tie, the faceless wonder, and people were writing in saying, why don't you get people with faces instead of these creatures we have before you? And I looked much younger than I was. I looked about 16. I was, in fact, then about 24. And I used to get all kinds of offensive letters asking me what shade lipstick I wore and what size tights. And I used to pretend it didn't matter, and I'd be trembling with rage because I'm a 100% all-American red-blooded boy, really. And I was frustrated by the job because it was a useful stepping stone, I thought, but to what, I wasn't sure. Mm. And then they said, would you like to do some news reading, which was different from announcing. Yes. Richard Baker went on holiday. I went up to Alexander Palace to sit in for him and stayed there for 8 years, reading the news on television, which again was stepping from one straight-laced job to another because you just read other people's words aloud off a moving toilet roll. Mm. You weren't allowed to have any hand in writing it because that was personal feelings.
Yes.
But I did, as much as I was allowed to, do other programs, because at that time you weren't allowed, of course, as a newsreader to take part in a comedy program. You couldn't have a pie in the face and then go on and read Death of the Prime Minister. So I used to be allowed to do, like, introducing the Red Navy singers and dancers and programs like that, but they never paid me for it. That was sort of staff, no fee. So they got a lot of mileage out of this slave labor. and gradually I got more and more frustrated by this, because all this thing about newsreaders being stars now is absolute nonsense, you see, because a newsreader just sits there and reads words aloud. Mm. And this great star thing always eludes me entirely. Because, and I got into bad waters, really, with some of the ex-colleagues by saying that newsreading wasn't a full-time job. You just turned up 3 days a week, you did 2 hours of work, went to the club, had a very nice time, met all your pals, and went home. Mm. And it was a sinecure, it wasn't a job at all. So eventually I wriggled and wriggled like a chrysalis until someone said, we'll offer you an early evening chat show and we'll give you Crackerjack.
Oh, I see.
And family favourites, dear old things like that. So I thought, well, that's a nice little package deal to risk going freelance. And that was in 1968. And that's what happened.
Even in Crackerjack, you played the role of a straight man and people poked fun at you because you were less zany than all the others.
That's right. You see, what happened was they had... Well, I mean, Eamon Andrews was the very first, of course, and they don't come a lot straighter than Mr. Eamon. And I was cast in that mould, because they couldn't. I suppose it would have been too much of a culture shock or something for me to suddenly spring on with the red nose. And I was, when Leslie Crowther left it, they really sort of replaced him by two people. One was an entertainer called Rod McLennan, and I was the other thing, doing the intros. But I was allowed to get into silly clothes at the end of the programme. Get a pie in the face.
Oh, yes.
Also, they broke my wrist on that programme.
Really? How did that happen?
Well, I was thrown into a 12-foot custard pie.
Oh, dear.
It's about as different from newsreaders you can get.
Yes.
And it was crazy foam, and the floor was as hard as this studio is. Mm. And we couldn't rehearse it, of course. So instead of being lightly pushed in, I was hurled at an angle of 45 degrees and went whistling through this stuff and smack and sat up thinking, well, I can't die on a children's programme, I better sit up. Carried on. And the next morning, I woke up, and there were these blue sausages for fingers.
Oh,
and
all that.
And I went to hospital, and they said, yes, you've broken it. I was quite proud, really. I liked it. A broken limb. And I thought BBC paid me thousands. Of course, they told me I did it deliberately. And when I came out of hospital, by amazing chance, there was the producer of Crackerjack, and I came up with all these bandages. And he said, my God, surely not. I said, yes, it was the show. And he said, oh, my God, how terrible. All those reports I'd have to write, all that paper.
Oh, sympathy, yes.
Thank you very much. That's the BBC for you. It was an honour to work for them and an honour to be hurt by them.
So that's why you went over to ITV.
Well, I went over because they asked me. I mean, I did Crackerjack for a few years. That was all right. And I did Dear Old Family Favourites. And I did the Today programme at weekends occasionally, which was kind of magazine-y stuff, which I liked best of all, really.
So you don't you prefer that to the comedy role?
Yes, because I mean I can tell jokes quite well and used to enjoy the bar chat, but it's all right making your pals laugh in an ad lib situation, but to actually do a rehearsed thing is that's where skill and technique comes in, and I don't really have that. But I used to enjoy, you see, when I was on the news and when I did the Today programme, being a facetious kind of bloke as well, I would look for light items that one could pick up and use.
Yes,
and I did that on the Today programme. It was the Saturdays that I did, and John Timpson, who, as you know, does the weekday programme, he said on a Friday, he told me about this, he said one Friday morning, that's all for today, Mike Aspel will be here tomorrow. And he had a letter 2 days later from a woman who said, oh, why did you tell us your gas bill would be arriving the next day? It's good, isn't it?
Oh, dear. Yes, it's rather embarrassing.
Sorry.
Yes, I see. So you...
Well, I wanted to do more acting. I mean, I didn't really want to... get away. Your time whizzes past. I really didn't want to get away from the original idea, which was to be an actor. Mm. But suddenly I'd been in broadcasting for, I don't know, 15, 20 years then, and I hadn't really been doing much of my original idea. But I was asked out of the blue if I wanted to do a stage play, private lives, which I did, and met my present wife doing that. So it, wish I had never done it, really, but it was fun. I did enjoy it. But that was just a question of someone using someone from the telly to bring people into the theatre. And I've done a few plays on that basis. And you know, the professionals are very kind, but you can see they're thinking, somebody get this bum out of here. You know?
So, through appearing on television and on the radio a lot, you became the sort of personality who compares Miss World.
Yes, a general useful dog's body. And I think my usefulness was, that, having done the news and current affairs programmes for 8 years, and cameras breaking down, and late stories, and having to read other people's handwriting, they knew that I could be quite useful when everything collapsed around me. Somehow I managed just to keep going. And the Miss World was only one night of the year, but it did at that time get 28 million viewers. And I got tagged with that one. I did it for laughs. I don't know if anybody ever noticed that, but I used to play it for laughs. But after some years, I thought the jokes got a bit thin and I wanted to escape from it, but I got persuaded back. And the trouble with doing that kind of thing is that although it is one night of the year, people, as I said, tag you with it, and when your name is put up for more worthwhile programmes, people say, ah, no, that's the news, the Miss World compare, we're not interested.
So is there other more worthwhile programmes that you'd like to do, which you haven't been offered?
Well, I mean, I wouldn't like to do Panorama. No, I'm not a political, I'm not a journalist. But I've thought up a few ideas for programmes, which is always a dangerous thing, because they don't accept your ideas, but they use them. But that is a cynical thing, but I've had a lot of people will tell you that is what happens. Television swallows up ideas and doesn't always give credit. And I have had a few approaches for doing more drama, but I've got a new program coming up, I hope, in January for an LWT.
The 6 o'clock show.
Yes, which really goes full circle, and it's going to be a news but light-hearted ad-lib kind of thing, which might be satisfying.
I've got a quote here from Michael Grade, LWT program controller, and he says you've got a certain credibility as a purveyor of news, and that you've also got a popular peak time charm. Now, what do you think about that?
Perceptive man, isn't he?
I see, yes.
He said another nice thing, not about me, but about somebody. My wife is an actress, as I said, and she was in that Lily series, which was LWT, and there were a few speeches at the end of the show when they had a party, and up sprang the producer with a jacket on that looked like an attack of migraine. It was all black and silver and spots and dashes, and Michael Grade looked at this jacket and said, if you had an outdoor aerial, you could get rid of all that. So he's quite a bright lad, and he's going to America, so we've lost him.
I see, yes.
But he apparently thinks I can do it, because I suppose Terry Wogan hasn't got the time.
I see, yes. I sort of read an article in the Evening Standard which said that LWT were trying to get rid of the idea that you were second choice. I mean, do you feel you are second choice to Terry Wogan? I mean, how does that make you feel?
Well, of course, that's not pleasing. I mean, I don't think anybody would want to be second choice. And we all have our time. And in 68, when I went freelance, I was on almost every television programme there could be. And then I started saying, no, I don't want to wear a dinner suit and go in any more theatre foyers welcoming the stars and all that. I really don't want to do that. So they say, all right, sod you, and you are not asked again. It's currently Terry Wogan's time, and great. I think he does a marvellous job.
You've got a weekday programme on Capital. How do you feel about working on the radio, doing the same show at the same time every day, live every week?
Well, the worst part about it is the traffic. I mean, it took me an hour and 40 minutes to drive 7 miles this morning. But I like it very much. I was taken on by Capital 7 years ago because they wanted a smoothie to rule the housewives. That was my designation. And it used to make me curl up, because I hated that. But I mean, I see that that's what I appeared to be. So that's all right. But what we're doing now on the programme is very different from the original idea. I mean, of course I talk to housewives, but it's because disc jockeys know about the pop world. They read the trade journals. It's their life. It isn't mine. I'm totally ignorant about it, and I don't qualify for the description.
So you're sort of playing the same sort of role as Jimmy Young, perhaps?
Steady, huh? Yeah, it's more of a magazine programme.
I see. I mean, I'm just sort of thinking how you feel about this being sort of treated by television and radio companies as a commodity. They can compare you with someone else and they buy you for a particular purpose and then just use you. I mean, how do you feel about that?
I think it's terrific. I mean, I mean, the commodity is myself. I mean, you offer it, and you have to, you have to take not only the fact that you are, as you say, a piece of meat that's being flogged around, but also you have to take the snide and the unpleasantness and the digging into things that are nobody else's business. I mean, you offer yourself up. You have to expect this, and then it happens. But that is show business.
Do you often find yourself doing programmes that you don't, in fact, enjoy?
Oh, yes, all my life. I mean, I have done things that I've loathed, but I've got a lot of kids, and I've got one or two ex-wives, and I've got to earn as much money as I can to pay for my sins. So, you know, that's another thing one has to accept. But there are things I don't enjoy, and there are things... You know, the ironic thing about life is the things you really enjoy that are worth doing. This applies not just to the sort of silly trade that I do. Mm. Is that you get paid a lot for the nonsense, and by only doing things you really want to do, like school broadcasts and writing scripts that I really enjoy, there's no money in that at all. You have to do the dross to be able to survive. And I mean, commercials, for example. I've just done this thing for London Transport about the fares. I forget what it's called, Fair Deal. And when I agreed just to introduce this for them and tell people about the reduced things, then I was told about the rates increase that was going to pay for all this. I said, what do I have to say when people come up to me in the street and say, you bum, you know, which is what people do. And they said, well, what you must say is that it's the GLC, it's Ken Livingstone whose idea it is, and he's the man. It hasn't stopped the letters. I mean, the abuse has been considerable.
People associate it with you personally.
Well, again, I'm setting myself up, aren't I? I'm saying, here we are, it's all right. I said, look, I mustn't ever be seen to be saying how wonderful this is. I must just be an investigative reporter and saying the facts and nothing else. But of course, you're up there speaking for London Transport, and you're the bloke they attack, which is, I suppose, natural.
Assuming that you do go out into the streets, how do you feel about seeing your posters everywhere you look on bus stops?
Well, I'm interested to see the latest graffiti, really, and how many blacked-out teeth and how many moustaches and all that. Of course, I don't go by bus. I don't deny that. I never go by bus, and I rarely go by tube.
Do you think that sort of the man in the street is fooled into thinking that because he sees your poster on the tube that therefore... you do. I mean,
no, I don't think anybody's fooled by that. I think they just see me in my role as newsreader, purveyor of facts, and all that in that slightly twilight zone. Very few people. When I say abuse, I mean I've only had a few letters, but I suppose three letters could represent many thousands if you work out the ratio. Mm. It's enough to be disturbing, but I don't think anybody regards. I mean, there was a stigma about doing any kind of commercial at one time until I think Olivier did one. And then everybody wanted to do it. It was all right. Yes. So, you know, it's a fairly grubby way of making a living, really. Mm. But it's the money, you see.
I see. I can't blame you for that.
I read somewhere that your childhood ambition is to be a film star. Is that something that you still like to do?
Well, yes. Yes, of course it was. I wanted to be everything. A cowboy, which is very unlikely for a boy from Wandsworth. But, I mean, that's the kind of daft ambitions you have. But, you know, through the work that I do, I've met a lot of actors and film stars. Mm. I've got a great rapport with their work and all that. And I love filming, even if it's just doing a report for a local news thing. Yes, I would have liked to do that. The older you get, the more you realise how little you had to offer in the first place. But the conceit of youth is always there. And if they want somebody to look really depraved, I think I might do a good performance for them. I was born with these bags under the eye.
Talking about getting offers to do a job and then getting paid sums for doing it, I read that you wanted to work in the United States, but no one's ever made you an offer for that.
No, it's funny. That's just really this United States obsession is a thing to do with my generation, because when I was a kid, America was the dream. America was where everything modern and wonderful was. In Britain, we didn't have skyscrapers, we didn't have glamour, we didn't have these great ritzy clothes, and all we had was austerity. So America was the dream. And I was 40 before I went there, and I tried time and time again to get to America, and I loved it so much I went back as often as I could. And I still have this love affair with the place. I mean, what is America? I've only seen a few spots of it, so I don't know it at all. I've done a bit of broadcasting over there, and I would like to do some work, but there's no reason in the world why anybody should ask me to go there. But interestingly enough, there's some I've had a few people on programmes doing tarot cards, and it always seems to come up. America, America. I don't know when, because I've just signed for 2 years for London Weekend, so I should be a very old American.
I see. Well, thank you very much for coming along today. And I expect we'll see you many more times and hear you many more times on the television and radio.
Might happen, yeah. Thank you very much.
And now, a perfect end to a perfect interview. We've got a clip from the Kenny Everett video show, and I'm sure it's a role that you'll never want to play again.
He's answered all three questions correctly, gained the maximum 10 points on each one, but has he got the 31 points required to win? Dratty-poos! He's missed by 1 point, and he never even said the secret word, which, as we all want to know, is anathema. What are we going to do? He's too nice and made to get the ganj. Tell you what, telephone us right now on this number, 011-243-748-306855, etc. If you want to save Michael from the ganj, don't worry, Mike, it's going to be great. Your fans will save you. Ring now! Michael, they've let you down. He loses. Give him the ganj!
That's it from Star Quiz for this week. Hope you enjoyed it. We certainly did.
I knew he'd lose.
And now the weather forecast.